10 cats. Something for the weekend. It's Louise Redknapp. The Kane event. It's Russell Kane. And their team captain, Sean Locke. And facing them tonight, wrap it up, it's Example. Stand-up guy, it's Mark Watson. And their team captain, John Richardson. Now, welcome your host, Jimmy Carr.
Hello, and welcome to 8 out of 10 Cats Uncut, a show all about opinion polls, surveys and statistics. Did you know, for example, a survey recently revealed the average British worker spends 25 minutes on Facebook every day, and that figure rises to 4 hours if they answer the question honestly. 4 out of 10 workplace relationships result in marriage, and 6 in 10 result in a written warning about the incident in the stationery cupboard. And almost a third of men aged between 20 and 34 live at home with their parents, the most common reasons being cost, convenience, and if you're from Norfolk, sex on tap. Right, let's get started. What are you talking about? That's the name of our first round. It's our panellists' job to guess the British public's top five most popular talking points. John, Mark, Example. Are we going to call you Elliot or Example?
Call me by my real name, just for this show.
OK, Example.
Elliot.
Well, I watched X Factor this week, and it was very exciting, cos Cecil was off sick, so Nadia had to step in. Neville was in the bottom two, cos Phyllis said his song choice was all wrong. Anyway, he got saved and Humphrey's gone out. And I might have got the names wrong, but frankly, who gives a shit? Because the one I hate is Frankie Kokoza. Oh. They're desperate to report that he's cool in my desperate campaign against the most despicable human on earth. This week they said he's been out on a 12-hour bender. He went to Wetherspoons and had a few beers with his mates. Then they went to a club, he got ID'd, and they went back to a house. That's hardly like Oasis throwing a donkey through a hotel window or anything, is it? He got ID'd and he went home. That's not a bender, is it? And then he took 3 girls this week to car parks.
What?
He took them to car... Well, fair play, it's more expensive to take a girl to an NCP car park than a hotel.
I hate it. You've got to have no talent at all and go on there and... they're awful.
Have you heard Frankie Kokoza?
Leona Lewis, no talent?
Well, she can sing, but that's about it.
Yeah, but she's a singer, so that's, like, the most important part.
Well, I can't sing as good as her, but I've been struggling for years to get to this position, to get on this show.
Looking now, though.
It is a weird thing, though, because, like, from your world, from sort of, you know, if you're a rapper, could a rapper ever get anywhere
on X Factor?
Well,
it's not even rapper. It's like, you know, anyone who started off from, like, you know, grassroots or underground, you know, like, touring for years. Like, I've done nearly 1,500 gigs and, you know, sort of, you do all these gigs. It's a bit, you know, like stand-up comedy, you know, start off at the bottom and just build your way up, and then if you're good, you get a chance at making it if you work really hard. And these guys, seemingly, just come out of nowhere on TV for a couple of months and then they've, you know, record contracts and...
A lot of them on X Factor go on to become household names, like and then... Vanish.
I thought it was completely laughable. They had Alexandra Burke as a guest judge on there. That's like having Stevie Wonder judging Miss World, isn't it? It's like... you know, everyone's got an opinion. Loads of people think I'm awful, so I don't really mind.
Louis Walsh, what do you think about him?
Well, you know, he's all right. I met Louis in Dublin, and I was offered to write songs for, you know, the winners, cos I can write songs.
Did you?
And he was like, we need hits! We need hits!
That is exactly how I imagine he said
we need hits, 1,000,000% hits!
From what I can look at, his job on the show seems to just be to explain where people are from and what they look like. Every time he says, John, you're tall, you're from Ireland. And that's basically... I could probably do that, Louis. Every contestant. Sharon, you're a girl, you sing songs, you were born in 1985.
I mean, if they covered one of your songs, wouldn't that just kill it for you, your credibility as an artist?
Well, no, I mean, I'd probably have a choice in that.
Would you have a choice?
Can they?
No. I don't think you do.
I'd like to hear Johnny Robinson do some... do some examples. Johnny Robinson does Example.
Louise, do you love it? Do you like it?
Well, yeah, I like it. I like a good Saturday night in with a bit of strictly an X Factor.
The Kelly thing, Kelly being ill, did you buy that? Did you...
God, no. So totally like a cover for, you know, Simon's keeping her on the back burner because he wants a bit of drama in the show. I mean, if you can't see through that, Jimmy, where have you been?
She was croaking.
Get over it.
She was croaking. Hello. I'm really sad. Like, she did sound ill.
Your throat doesn't stop you flying, does it?
Do you reckon...
Nothing stops you flying, really.
No, you're in a plane.
I think if you've got, like, a really contagious fever...
If you've got a bomb in your shoe.
Yeah. I've got bombs in my shoes.
I can't come. I got a bomb in my shoes.
I can't come. I've been radicalised. Let me fly.
Let's have a look and see if X Factor is up there.
My man wants to see.
Yes, X Factor. Kelly Rowland was ill last week, but this week she's been attached to a drip. Louis Walsh. Kitty used to be a Britney Spears impersonator, mainly the bit where she had a breakdown and had her kids taken away. Sean, Louise, Russell, what have the nation been talking about this week?
Well, the thing that seems to be dominating the news is the bloody Greeks. Bloody Greeks, isn't it? It's the Greeks.
All right, Michael Caine.
Yeah. Yeah, they've been offered a bailout package. And they said, oh, great, we're going to give some help, we'll help you out. They go, oh, thanks. They've come for help, asked for help, been offered help. And then they said, just check everyone's fine with having that help. But if you've broken down and somebody pulls over and offers you help, you don't go, I'll just check with everybody in the car that they're fine travelling in your Astra.
I'm saying if they give this bailout to Greece, it's going to cost every family in the UK 14 grand. Mm. It's not like they're going to knock on the door going, it's Greece, I'll come for the money. But I only earned £15,000. Well, you better start learning how to bake bread, darling.
We shouldn't give them any more money. We shouldn't give them another penny. It's not safe. It's like leaving all your savings in a clown's pocket. They just spend it.
Who decided to let Greece come into the Euro? Whose decision was that?
I don't know. I think Timmy Mamet was involved. They need to produce something, the Greeks. They need to find a way of earning the money. It's not just a bailout. They need to, you know, maybe some kind of transatlantic banana that people can ride across the Atlantic on a big banana.
They might be expelled. Like, and I just love the idea of Angela Merkel expelling Greece. You know, the German emperor going, you have disappointed us, Greece. They're Sarkozy, like an evil assistant. Yes. Get rid of them, sire.
Well, they're in trouble because I worked it out this week. You know when you work all year to get money and then you go on holiday for 2 weeks? But that's where they live.
Yeah. They're basically always on holiday.
They live on holiday.
Yeah.
So, like, they have...
That is a very, very good point.
They get through the year and they go, do you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go for 2 weeks in Swindon and I'll go work in the Motorola factory for them. I'm going to do all the big things. I'm going to check in, I'm going to check out, I'm going to eat in the canteen. I tell you what, you come back more tired than when you went away. I'm not going to joke.
I can't decide whether it's racist or not, but I like it.
It's really expensive to go to Greece for a holiday. You can get there cheaply, but when you're there, the food's expensive, getting in places, hotels are expensive.
You should have gone to Thomas Cook.
They've straight into that one, didn't I?
In those adverts, why is Jamie playing golf with his shirt off?
Do you know what? I have to take...
I don't want to play in a club where there's a man running around with his shirt off.
I take...
Is he doing a bit of scaffolding while he was there?
He never lets me live that down because I was like, you know, it'd be arty, it'd be cool. And I let him, he's like, okay, I'll do it. And then.
Did you tell him to do it?
I did. And he's got so much stick from that one shot of him on the beach.
Your family do everything, don't they? Do like M&S, Nintendo, don't you do everything?
Yeah, we're grinning and banking it, example. Grinning and banking it.
I've announced a European tour. Tickets available now if anyone's watching
Latvia
or something. No, no, seriously, because there's no one watching in Europe.
No, this is...
What's the point, then?
This show's massive in Thessalonica.
European tour's on sale now. watching in Scandinavia. We've only sold 4 tickets in Stockholm, that's the truth.
You think there's people watching in Scandinavia?
You've sold 4 tickets in Stockholm?
It's weird. It's
how big's the venue? It's like an 8-seater. You're doing the gig on the bus.
It's about 500. But, I mean, if there's any Scandinavian people watching in England, maybe fly back to Stockholm next March. It's going to be a good show.
I think it helps if you say it like you mean it.
Yeah. Be a really good show. On my Facebook, they're like, why aren't you coming Greece? Why aren't you coming Greece? Why aren't you coming... You know, don't discriminate against Greece because it's the only place I'm not doing in Europe. And I'm like, you know, what are you going to pay me in smash plates or something?
So let's have a look and see if the Greek crisis is up there. The Eurozone crisis continues. This could bring the Greek economy to a standstill, which basically means the stick turning the kebab will stop rotating and only one side of the meat will get cooked. It's a disaster. The Greek Prime Minister, George Papandreou, may resign. I suppose if he does, he'll have to go back to his previous job running the laundrette in EastEnders. Johnstein, what else do you think the nation should be talking about this week?
It's the fact that Ainsley Harriott exploded. Fortunately, I know that didn't happen, but I received a large amount of payment to make a wrong guess deliberately. They've been doing big cheating, the cricketers.
Yeah.
And
that's what they said in court, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Have been doing big cheating.
And the big news is that it still hasn't really made cricket interesting. Because, like, it's not like... You know they make films about boxing scandals? It's not like, hey, you're going to go down in the fifth. This is like, hey, on day 3, just after tea, can you throw it a bit away from the man?
Yeah.
The thing that I like most about it is the fact that one of them's called But and one of them's called As If, which is sort of like... seems like they're excuses.
But...
As If...
The best thing about the story for me is they were caught, and he's my favourite journalist, they were caught by the fake shake.
Yeah.
I love the fake shake. I love how the fake shake catches people. He just walks in like... He goes... Hey, I want some cocaine and to fix some cricket matches. Can you help me? And they're all these people who get caught by the fake shake never think to themselves, what's a shake doing in a travel lodge on the A1?
Yeah.
I think people are surprised because they assume cricket isn't dirty, but most sports, there's corruption. There's boxing, football... Horse racing is just so bent, it's ridiculous. In fact, there's only one sport that isn't corrupt, and that's crazy golf. You can't fix it.
I'm crazy golf today.
Yeah. In the crocodile's mouth, that can take 10 minutes. It comes out of the tail, then you go, oh, I've got to get through the windmill now. That can take
possible, yeah.
I've played games of crazy golf that lasted longer than test matches. You played crazy golf today.
Did
Jamie have his shirt off?
No, not today. It was spitting.
Just golf. Yeah, just crazy golf.
I played crazy golf where we live, and it's all dinosaurs.
So where you live? You've got crazy golf.
No, just down the road. Just down the road. Off of the A3.
Crazy golf on the A3 sounds dangerous.
Dinosaur crazy golf.
Yeah, dinosaur crazy golf with a 7-year-old and a 2-year-old, and you're right, it took us about 4 hours. By the end of it, I was pulling
out my hair. A 7-year-old and a 2-year-old, you should have bought clubs. Elliot, are you a big fan of cricket?
I hate cricket, that's why I said anything. I was trying to think of something funny, I was like, I hate cricket so much, I don't even know the rules. I like this program, but I don't like cricket.
OK, well, let's have a look and see whether the Pakistan cricketing scandal is one of the most talked-about things this week. Yeah, just made it in. The former Pakistan captain, Salman Butt, has been found guilty of match-fixing. He's going to spend 30 months not out. Sean, Louise, Russell, what else have the nation been talking about this week?
St. Paul's.
Yeah.
St. Paul's protest. Have you been down there, Russell?
No.
Haven't you?
I'm not posh enough. It's just a load of middle-class people going, let's have a year off our degrees and pelts and paws. Here's a quail's egg. It's a tomato that sunblushed you mofos. Take that at the banks.
They're not really camping there, are they? They're going home.
Let's go back on our gap year. Brown person, photo. Back to the UK, hooray!
You
does feel a little bit like that some middle-class people saw Dale Farm and thought, that looks fun.
That looks so random.
We should do that.
How random does that look, Ollie? Let's do it. Oh, my God, the totes love it. WTF, what's going on?
I went down there. I went down there to have a look. I went down there to sort of do a review for Campsite magazine. I gave it 3 stars because I said the drainage is amazing, because obviously Christopher Wren knew a thing or two about, you build it on a hill. Very good drainage there as a campsite, and very good entertainment facilities. You've got your pubs, your sightseeing, and of course there's a chapel on site. Not much for the kiddies. Not very much outrageous for kiddies. And the toilet block is frankly a disgrace. I did actually go there. I didn't hang around to use the toilets. I did actually go there. And there is quite a sort of buoyant atmosphere there, but there's loads of people offering free hugs. And I went up to this girl who was offering free hugs. I said, what'd you get for a tenner? She spat on me and called me a capitalist pig. I said, I'd pay 20 for that.
Why are they there?
Why are they there? Well, they're there because they weren't allowed to protest in the City of London outside where the City of London operates. And St Paul's is a church, so they thought, well, we can protest here, it's near enough. And then the church stepped in and went, well, we don't want you on our doorstep because we're making 16 grand a day selling candles or whatever the church is doing. I mean, the people I feel sorry for in this argument between the protesters and the church are the bankers. It's almost like they'd be forgotten.
No one's asking, how is a church making 16 grand a day? That's £5.8 million a year. I reckon they've got Gordon Ramsay's swear box in there. That's how they do it.
They've got a coffee machine. No, I tell you, the first time I went to St Paul's, that's how you make money, coffee machines.
£6 lattes.
Coffee, anything, any kind of business. If I had any kind of business, if I had a shoe shop, I'd put a coffee machine in it. Just people just pay it. They'll pay so much money for some bitter water. But I remember going to St Paul's for the first time about 15 years ago, and I was quite shocked. When you walk in, you see priests on tills. And you think, there's something slightly wrong with this, because one of those famous statements of Jesus is, it's easier for a camel to pass through an eye of a needle than the rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And there's a priest going, ching-ching! That'll be £4.90, please.
Oh, man.
See, I think it's... I sympathise with them in some ways, but it's hard to take their opinion seriously because these people are voluntarily camping. Camping's not a holiday. If you're on holiday, just quick checklist. Am I shitting in a bush? Yes, this isn't a holiday.
You can do glamping now, though.
Glamping?
Glamping.
Glamour camping.
One, isn't
so,
it?
Basically, you have your tent and you get a little chandelier and...
What?
It's all posh and...
You still have to shit in a bush, though.
Apparently, yeah.
Just like to correct this thing about, you know, if anyone out there is thinking of having a camping holiday, some of the toilet facilities that are available at campsites across the country, really, you'll be not disappointed, but they're very, camping is so...
They make me heave the toilets up.
I like that feeling.
Walking with the kids going,
oh. You can combine that with a match run up
a leg. I like it on a campsite. You go to a campsite and it's pissing with rain and there's just all dads in the toilets and they've got 3 days in a tent with loads of kids. That's when I think this is when it really gets exciting. In the toilet block, brushing their teeth, going, stinking of whiskey, smuggling whiskey in their toilet bag.
We're talking about St Paul's and the protests against...
Why are they even there?
Got sidetracked.
They're spreading. Well, the papers are reporting that, oh, it's not just London now, it's spreading, but I think they're just counting homeless people. Because they're reported that there are 6 people in Birmingham. That's not a protest against global... That's the most depressing indictment of the fact that no-one really cares. 6 tents in the centre of Birmingham. Bring down the capitalists.
Well, look, don't diss the fact that it's 6 people, because, you know, poor Elliot here has got to go to Stockholm and take a fall. Let's have a look and see whether the protests at St Paul's are one of the most talked about things this week. Most talked about thing. Yes, protesters continue to camp outside St Paul's Cathedral. In response to the ongoing protests, Barclays closed its doors, Goldman Sachs gave all its profits to charity, and a flock of pigs swooped majestically across the city sky. Fingers on buzzers, one more thing to get.
Justin Bieber's meant to have fathered the child.
Yeah, but it's extraordinary because Justin Bieber's only 17.
He's the first. It's why it's in the papers. He's the first four-year-old even to be alleged to have a baby.
No, he's 17 years of age, but apparently he's had a. Why have we stopped it?
Love is that
it.
One of his songs?
Is that one of his
songs? I genuinely didn't know anything he'd done. I didn't know you could get... Cos they keep describing it as a romp.
Yeah.
Which makes me a bit jealous, cos I don't think I've ever romped. I think I frolicked once, but I'm not sure. But as apparently it was a 30-second romp, and you certainly can't... That's like having a 12-course snack.
Yeah. Yeah. 15 seconds of that was probably untucking his vest from his Spider-Man pants.
Justin Bieber strenuously denies the allegations, but...
How do you strenuously go, no! No! I didn't. He probably doesn't even know he did it. With that hair, you know his hair, it's like a sheepdog, isn't it? He probably thought he went for a really comfy piss.
From this day on, that is how I'm referring to sex.
Who are you?
Let's have a look and see whether Justin Bieber is up there. Well, allegedly up there. Yes, it's been alleged Justin Bieber has fathered a love child with a fan. It's alleged Bieber only had sex with a girl once and that it lasted 30 seconds. That's pathetic. I could do it twice in 30 seconds. So, those were the most talked-about stories this week. But in other news, according to the UN, there are now 7 billion people in the world. The bad news is, two of them are Kitty Brucknell and Frankie Kokoza. And it's bonfire night this weekend. I hope our neighbours keep their pets locked up, because there's something about fireworks that make me really randy. So, at the end of that round, Sean, Russell and Louise have 2 points, John, example and Mark have 3 points. Part one, see you after the break. Welcome back to 8 out of 10 Cats Uncut. Our next round is Pick of the Polls. Sean, Louise, Russell, pick a question.
The man with his thumbs up.
This is your related question. Most people think children today are given too much praise. Mm. True or false?
Children do get praised too much. For example, I mean, my kids, they get praised for, like, eating peas. And they eat some peas, and even they spit them out and go... Pff, 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 pff. Still go, oh, well done for trying the peas. Hundreds of years ago, they've been shoved up chimneys. And everybody's going, well done, you've eaten some peas.
Yes,
oh, you clever. And any piece of storming scribble ends up on the fridge. Anything, just me shit. You just go, what is that? Have you drawn an amoeba? What the... Oh, Christ. It's a tiger or a house. You don't know. And then it ends up on the fridge. In my day, it was either the Blue Peter Gallery or the bin.
Yeah.
Do you praise your children?
I do. I encourage them because I want them to be confident, and I think children can really, I know, they can take everything in like a sponge and then their confidence can go. So I think it's important to encourage kids.
Mm. Your perception's totally skewed by my old man. That's why I've got no, like, everything my dad's good at is the stuff I'm shit at, and everything he didn't like is the stuff I was good at, because I had to just be opposite to him. Like, he's got all the physical skills. He can look at a shelf and put it up, get up, slag, and it just goes up like that.
What about kids these days? Do you think kids are kind of given too much praise?
Yeah, definitely. My dad was a bit harsh on me. He's like, I'm going to get in the music game. He was like, good luck with that. And yeah. He was like, come to me when you've got a top 40. I was like, Dad, I'm number 19 of charts. He's like, come to me when you've got a top 10. I was like, Dad, I'm number 6. So, I'm Dad, come to me when you're number 1. I was like, Dad, I'm number 1. He's like, come to me when you sold out Sweden.
Right,
My dad, he was quite interesting. He would give you some encouragement if, you know, on certain things. Like, he used to play that game. You know that game, Spine in a Sack? We used to play that. Do you ever play that?
Spine.
Spine. You ever play that when you were a kid? Spine in a Sack.
Spine in a Sack.
Spine in a Sack.
It sounds more like
what
a
he'd do,
injury.
What he'd do is he'd go out and get some roadkill. Anyway, he's getting roadkill, and he'd whip the spine out, get the old spine out, then he'd break up all the vertebrae, put it in a sack, then he'd bounce it on our heads, right, and we'd have to guess what animal it was.
Oh! Spine in a Sack.
Spine in a
spine
Sack.
In a Sack.
Yeah. I mean, you probably called it something different, back in a bag or something. Whatever, it's the same game. I'd
Are
go...
you guys winding me up? Is there really a
And I go, oh, is it chipmunk, Dad? And you go, don't be stupid, that's not even indigenous. How am I going to find that on a road? Harder, Sean, work harder!
Do you never play it?
No, I'm really shocked, because I don't know if you're winding me up or not. I'd be mortified if my dad put a dead animal on my head.
This is in the 60s. I think my dad was taking a lot of drugs at that time.
Honestly, I don't know what to think.
No, he didn't know. I made it up for a joke. Very nice man, my dad. Very nice.
He did play
man.
Kidneys in a Shoe, though, didn't he?
Yeah. John, what do you think? Most people think children today are given too much praise. What do you think?
I'm with Louise. I don't really know what to think about what's happened in the last 5 minutes. Well, the thing is, if you praise someone, then they'll think that that's what they should carry on doing. Whereas if you don't praise them, they'll want to do more. So I'm all for saying to kids, that is shit.
See, okay. I feel out of place here because I've got a kid and I'm a loving father.
Do you praise your kid?
All the time.
How old is it?
Oh, he's a year and a half. He hasn't got a clue what I'm saying. Yeah.
That's the one time when you can slag it off and it's just fun because it can't understand. So you go, oh, you shit everything, aren't you?
Recently, I took him swimming and a kid that was only about five splashed him and I... He was only five, but I lost my temper and went, you dick. Looking back, I'm 31, I should have probably handled the situation with more dignity. Yeah.
OK, so most people think children today are given too much praise, true or false. What are you going to say, Sean?
What do you think?
I think you're right, I think they most probably think we should be tougher.
Yeah, OK, we'll go true then.
So you're going true? What are you going to go for, John?
Let's go false, make it exciting.
Why not?
I can tell you the answer is false.
Yes!
Yes, only 33% of people think children today are given too much praise. Children respond best to supportive praise and gentle encouragement, and if that doesn't work, lock them in their bedroom and tell them Santa's dead. John, example, Mark, pick a question.
Can we have the dentist?
The dentist, OK. Most people find hosting a party more stressful than going to the dentist. True or false?
That can't be true, can it?
Well, you nothing stressful about hosting a party, is there? Just establish the rules early.
What are the rules for a party, John?
Shoes off, disinfect yourself on the way in.
Is there a sheep dip on the way into your party?
I pick the music, no double dipping, don't look at me. Piss off by nine. Now we can have fun.
Yeah.
No double dipping.
Oh, don't bite it and dip it back in. Just spit straight into my hummus, why don't you?
John's idea of a party is if the pizza delivery boy uses the toilet.
Yeah, I've had some people round me. Such a busy night.
Boot. You like parties, mate, because so far your whole show has been, I hate cricket, I hate the accent.
Oh, I love parties.
There we go.
Here we go, then.
Dad, do you ever host a party?
No.
Please, do you ever host parties?
Yeah, I love putting on a party.
Stressful?
It is stressful, and I always get nervous that nobody's going to come. But
you've got loads of M&S food there, haven't you? And
BS in the living room.
Jamie's there, like, I've got my shirt off for ages. When are they coming?
Okay, John. Most people find hosting a party more stressful than going to the dentist. True or false?
We think it's false, Jimmy.
You think it's false? Okay. Sean Sim, what do you think?
I like holding parties, and I like going to the dentist. I'm just a great guy. I'm just an absolute ball of fun. Pain and fun.
There's a word for that. Kinky bugger.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, sometimes I roll around the garden naked with a carrot up my arse.
And then you release the rabbit.
Are you saying true or false?
We're saying it's true that a party has got to be more stressful than a day, because it's days of anticipation, whereas the dentist is just stressful on the day.
I can tell you, so you said false, you said true. I can tell you the answer is true.
Of course it is.
Yes. Yes, 54% of people find hosting a party more stressful than going to the dentist. What's more stressful than having to lie back and open wide while a strange man puts things in your mouth in a bedroom full of coats? The thing that scares me most about the dentist is having to read OK and Hello magazine from 1993. Ooh, look, Michael Barrymore's got a new house with a pool. Let's see how that pans out. So at the end of that round, it's 3 points for Sean's team and 4 points for John's team. That's it for part two. See you after the break. Welcome back to 8 out of 10 Cats Uncut. And the winner is the name of our final round. Here's your first one. Best way to make someone fancy you.
Lynx Africa.
He's right.
It does, yeah. I've been using it since I was 14.
What's the oldest man that's wearing Lynx? Are you seriously still wearing Lynx?
No.
What's wrong with Lynx?
We found him, he's here tonight. We found an adult male still going, yeah, ladies.
The thing I like about Lynx is it's very often two for a fiver.
There's nothing sexier than smelling like two for a fiver.
I think that's the answer to your question. Best way to make someone fancy you, a little bit of thrift. There's a thing called negging, which is apparently must make someone fancy you. Well, you say something horrible to someone, so that they then justify themselves to you. So you go, oh, those shoes. So they go, oh, no, he doesn't like my shoes. I'll try and impress him. And some people accuse me of negging without realising that I'm just a dick.
There always is treat them mean to keep them keen. That's what, like, growing up, my dad would always say to me, treat them mean, Lou, and keep them keen. Even if you really want to go on a date with them, you have to go, oh, no, I'm busy Tuesday, can't do that. And then you hope they ask you again.
If you really like someone and you say, oh, I can't do tonight, imagine how much you'd have to really love someone to say, get away from me, I never want to see you. If you ever ask me out on a date, John, again, I will have you killed.
She was just trying to keep you so keen.
Oh, that minx.
Yeah.
I think that a lot of people say that sense of humour is very, very attractive. And obviously that works for women. Women are attracted to men with sense of humour. Obviously it doesn't work for men, because women aren't funny. There is not one single... Do you know the statistics of men who've been laughed into bed? Zero.
Sean, you were very, very close.
Being funny.
Yes, yes, the best way to make someone fancy you is to make them laugh.
What?
Yeah. It's easy to laugh her into bed. The difficult bit comes 20 minutes later when you're trying to laugh her into a taxi home. In an experiment, scientists found that laughter raises serotonin levels, which increases a sense of well-being and a willingness to engage in sexual activity. The scientists also found that three lab chairs pushed together make a serviceable bed. They later discovered that funding for their department had been suspended pending an official investigation. OK, next question. Most annoying habit.
I got loads of these. People who breathe through their nose when they've got a cold and they've got a little snot flap.
Oh. Well, that is bad.
That's bad.
Clicking open and closed. How can you not hear that? People next door can hear that thing.
Yeah.
People who laugh at texts and then don't tell you.
Yeah.
Oh, who was that? Good man.
Yeah.
And then people who, when you're in a bit of a bad mood, keep asking you what's wrong. There's nothing wrong. Seriously, what's wrong? There's nothing wrong, I'm just in a bad mood. What's wrong? It's you now. Just get out of my face.
People who drink tea, that's an annoying habit. It's all the paraphernalia, the boiling of the kettles. We just cut that out, this country will be a lot more productive.
When someone comes round, you always go to put a kettle on.
I know.
Everyone does that.
Whereas you should get on with what they've come round for.
Go on, most annoying habit.
It's the thing you do. I can't stand it. That thing you do, like a little skip, you go, and then you go. What is this? You go, you skip, you go.
But Sean, you try it. If you walk from there to there, you've got to then turn round.
Look, you just do that.
Well, how would you? How would you do it? How would you do it?
Fine, let's see.
Not easy, Sean. Yeah, okay, all right. Sean Lock, everyone. Sean Lock.
You don't do this.
What is your problem? I've got a wobbly head. I've got a wobbly head.
Apart from that, I think you're great. I think you're amazing, Jimmy.
So, most annoying habit.
Nails picking.
That is the right answer.
Yes.
Nose picking. Yeah. Yes, the most annoying habit is nose picking. I tell you, he was terrible at nose picking. Michael Jackson. He just could not make up his mind. Well, that sound tells me it's the end of the round and the end of the show, which means the final scores are Sean, Russell, and Louise have 4 points, John, Elliot, and Mark have 5 points. They're tonight's winners.
Oh, my God.
To all our panellists, our wonderful studio audience, and to all of you for watching at home. That's it from us. Good night.